fall. I'm very touched that he would take the time and trouble to record that production. We tend to see religious issues that come before the court, usually alike. You have a long program this evening, and I've been asked to keep my remarks short, which I will do. I want to speak a little bit, at least, about the Establishment Clause. There are many ways in which one could organize the relationship between the church and state. I mentioned in one of my opinions a couple of terms ago that on the day, on 9/11, when the planes went into the Twin Towers, I happened to be at a conference of judges and lawyers in Rome. I was watching the tragedy as I was unpacking. That night, the president gave a talk to the people, which he concluded, as presidents often conclude their remarks, "God bless America." The next morning, I was approached by one of the European judges who was at the conference. And then he said to me, I remember it was really striking, how he wished that at a time of national crisis or national tragedy in his country, his president or his prime minister could be able to say in an address to the people, God bless what the country was. Because in most of the countries of Europe, that is absolutely forbidden. In Italy, in France, in Germany, it is défendu to have any reference to the Almighty. It is called in French the principle of secularism. That is not our American tradition, I'm happy to say. It is one way to organize things, but it's not the way we organize it. The American view is better represented by my experience in my childhood. I grew up here in New York, went to PS 13 in Queens. And in those days, we had a program called Released Time. I don't know if the New York schools still have it.
Do they?
Isn't that good? Well, if it works now, it's worked then, you know about it. But if you had a note from your parents, you could get out early on Wednesdays, I think it was, and go to your church or synagogue or wherever you wanted to go for religious instruction. It was a good deal. I mean, you got out early. Of course, the kids had to stay at school. You took your time getting there, kick cans through the gutters and whatnot. It was challenged in the courts by the ACLU. It was upheld by the Supreme Court in an opinion written by William O. Douglas, of all people, no conservative and no religious man he. But this is a verbatim excerpt from the opinion. The opinion said, "We are a religious people whose institutions presuppose a supreme being. When the state accommodates its schedule to the religious needs of our people, it acts in the best of our traditions." I agree with you. But unfortunately, within 10 years, the court did a 180-degree turn, and the principle which now supposedly governs our opinions is the principle of neutrality, which says that the state must be neutral not only between different denominations of religion, but it must
must be neutral between religiousness and non-religiousness. It cannot favor religion over non-religion. And that is still said to be, in our opinions, the rule that governs our cases. That rule does not, of course, represent the American tradition from the very beginning. You will often hear Thomas Jefferson's remark about the separation of church and state quoted. Don't be misled. Thomas Jefferson, I used to teach at the University of Virginia, so I know all this stuff. On his tombstone at Monticello, Thomas Jefferson directed that three of his accomplishments be set forth. One of them was not president of the United States, rather, author of the Declaration of American Independence. Second, author of the Statute of Virginia for Religious Freedom. And third, father of the University of Virginia, which he founded. All three of these accomplishments, it turns out, made place for the deity. The Declaration of Independence, of course, refers to the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle the American people. It appeals, quote, to the supreme judge of the world for the rectitude of our attentions. And it pledges the signatories lives, fortunes, and sacred honor, quote, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence. The Statute of Virginia for Religious Freedom, the second thing on this tombstone, begins as follows. Well aware that Almighty God hath created the mind free, that all attempts to influence it by temporal punishments or burdens or by civil incapacitations tend only to beget habits of hypocrisy and meanness, and are a departure from the plan of the holy author of our religion, who being Lord both of body and mind, yet chose not to propagate it by coercions on either, as was in his almighty power to do. And lastly, as for the University of Virginia, which Jefferson designed and supervised the building of, it had a room in its main building, the Rotunda, that was designed to accommodate religious services. And this is a state university, mind you. And it was reserved for that purpose at least as late as 1829, when a Presbyterian minister and an Episcopal clergyman were invited to preach on alternating Sundays. So if you hear about Jefferson's favoring the separation of church and state, do not be too quick to believe that it means the kind of separation that there is in Europe, the principle of laicisme. But it's not even only our ancient history. It's not even the years of the 1800s. It's even today that kind of extreme separation, that kind of banishment of the Almighty from the public forum is not part of America. Even when these cases come before my court, although the court continues to say that we must be neutral between religion and non-religion, nonetheless the court approves tax exemptions for houses of worship. Tax exemptions for philosophy houses, for houses of worship, and that's perfectly okay. And when there comes before the court the constitutionality of having ministers and rabbis open the session of legislatures with prayers, and even having paid clergymen to perform this service, the court approves it, while nonetheless mouthing the proposition that the principle of neutrality prevails. Queens, P.S. Barakiba, elementary school, down the road a bit in Manhattan, Xavier High School. And one of the things I learned there, I call the Shakespeare principle, which I think applies to the courts ignoring our traditions and making up its own notion of what the separation of church and state ought to be. The Shakespeare principle was explained to me by an elderly and quite crusty Jesuit in a class where we were studying Shakespeare. One of my classmates, I remember his name for some strange reason, John Antonelli, he was a real wise guy. He interjected the comment that, some critical comment about the play we were reading, I don't remember the play, Hamlet, whatever. It was a sophomoric, stupid thing. Father Tom Matthews looked down at him and said, with his Boston accent, "Mister, when you read Shakespeare, Shakespeare's not on trial. You are." I've always thought that's a very good prescription for life. And it's a very good prescription for the court's perception of what the Constitution means. It's not up to the court to make up for us a proper principle of separation of church and state, to make up for us what the Establishment Clause means. Rather, the court is tested, the court's principles are tested by the traditions of our society that they are supposed to faithfully reflect. Those traditions, as I say, are traditions that do not banish the Almighty from the public forum. And I will leave you with this one last thought. Some good comes of that. Indeed, some almighty good. It has been said, perhaps by more than one foreign leader, but I heard the remark attributed to Charles de Gaulle, and it sits rather well in his mouth. But it's true, and I think it is, the remark is true, and it is true because America has not banished the Almighty from the public forum. De Gaulle is supposed to have said, "God takes care of little children, drunkards, and the United States of America."
Thank you, Mr. Justice. Before you step down from the podium, I'd like to present you with a special token of our appreciation for your joining us here tonight. I hope the cameras can pick this up. It's a picture of a bearded man whom you might recognize, shaking hands with Rabbi Moshe Scherer, the late president of Agudas Yisroel. The picture was taken in 1997 at one of Agudas Yisroel's periodic national leadership missions to Washington, the very last Washington mission headed up by Rabbi Scherer. The memories of our visit to the Supreme Court under Rabbi Scherer's leadership and your address to us that day have stayed with us all these years and will stay with us forever. And now with this plaque, they will stay with you as well.
It takes a special person to not only understand the needs of others and the needs of the community, but to actually get involved and to do something to make a difference. Each year, Agudas Yisroel pays tribute to a select group of individuals. Individuals who make the chai of Hitohima a priority in their daily lives. Individuals who give of their time, their talent, and their resources to help both the Yotet and the Fah. These individuals are indeed, as we read in this week's Parsha, the Kruhei Ha'eda, individuals who are called upon to address the urgent matters affecting the community. This year, Agudas Yisroel presents Avodas HaKadosh Awards to Simcha David, Yaakov Schmieder, and Rabbi Goldstein, and presents the World Freedom Young Leadership Award to Rafi Bartel.
Sidish, 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 Sid
attacks that are being lobbed against Yiddishkeit, where, you know, traditionally used to come from the perhaps conservative right, whether it's fascism or, you know, Tsarist Russia or the Nazis. Nowadays, Yiddishkeit is being attacked on a more moral level, you know, from people, whether it's, you know, ethical treatment of animals, family rights, individual freedoms, like protecting Shrika, protecting Mila, you know, securing funds for Yeshiva, social programs, helping people to find jobs, for special education, security, lobbying for us both on a local and national level. Just acting as an eloquent and decisive voice in representing Yiddishkeit, which is something that now, more than ever, is something that we have a need for, somebody to stand up and defend Yiddishkeit. I think we don't need to show our support and our personality for the amazing and important work that they're doing for us. We all need to stand up and be counted among its supporters and among its members to say that, yes, Agudas speaks for me and Agudas speaks for my family. The work that they're doing for me is on behalf of myself, my family, my community. Their work is a vital necessity, and we support them wholeheartedly and fully of all their members.
I stand here to proclaim to you that we indeed embrace the mission statement of Rabbi Sher that I am privileged to hold here in my hand. We will not take for granted the Mesivas Nefesh of our Gedol Yisrael. We will not take for granted the selfless heroic devotion of the staff of Agudas Yisroel and their remarkable achievements. And we all united here this evening, we commit ourselves to securing the legacy of Rabbi Sher's 55 years of tireless service on behalf of Klal Yisroel, Reb Yisroel, through Agudas Yisroel. As we begin the second half of our program dedicated to commemorating the life and unparalleled accomplishments of our beloved leader, it is with great Yiras HaKadosh that we call upon the Yoshev Reish, Agudas Yisroel of America, Chaver Me'etzes Gedalia Torah, the Never Minster Rebbe Shlita. The Rebbe Shlita will address us both in Yiddish and in English.
Unsere Mutter wird es gehalten als Jeden aller Jungen. um die deutliche Erteilung der Deutschen von jener Gruppe beschlossen, ein bisschen man kann nicht rein zurück, ein Lieben soll sein, ein Chativa Achas. Aber wie weit möglich? Es soll sein weiter, dieser Chativa Achas sei, bei Achas Islam. Und das ist eben der heilige Messime von Agudas Yisroel, zu schaffen, ein tödliche Chativa Achas. Zu beschützen die Töne, den falschen Aschkoppes, kämpfen für alle Erkehatöne, für alle Kotschehörungen. Was sind das? Ach, der Tochter am Kodesh soll gedient werden mit der Koyach Marochat, durch Arabien, mit aller Herzen, was sie klappen zusammen. Das sind die Schliches und das sind die Isod. Na gut, es ist so. Teil wie ihn, sollen sich aber nicht vertrachten. In den letzten 60 Jahren, noch dem Chogen handelt und behoben, hat der Aschgocher in Jöne hereingescheint in unser heilige Macht, ne, a größer Ness, a chesser Niflo, bis wir haben das noch nicht gekannt, vorstellen. In friedlichen Jungen, als wird das so geschehen. Der Ebenstelle hat bei uns mit Kahn gewonnen. Verhinter der Augen, ein Neinu Heroes, der Busse in Jeschaie, was bist du mit ihr Kippe der Kaffteure? Wo wohnen im Chor, Chor, wo ist Eulam? Meist ein Dörr, wo Dörr zu kommen. Der Keulerische Geuter Peretz, beschreibt des Sibris des Jobes. Man hat sich Trick aufgestellt. Man beneidet den meisten Dörfer. Man hat gesagt zu sich allein und zum Ewigsten, als mich ganz Trick auf in seine Mischbuches, in seine Yeshivas, in seine Messiankips, in seine Meufes Achese. Wir wollen Trick werden, hat wieder die Gezimmer. Und der Ewigste hat geholfen. Er muss sich eben Theater des Schmaier. In meinen Augen, der muss kriegt sich an ihm, was geschehen mit dem Klagesäuer, in der, die alle 60 Jahre, kurz zu drei Böres, darf es immer chassig sein, der Munde, in der Aschwoche von Akkulisch-Borchu, auf Amoy-Waltre-Rossoy, wie also in die Sachen sind in meinen Augen bequem geworden. Hashem is God carried out before our eyes, the prophetic vision of rebuilding the ruins in our camp, of recreating an old new world on new soil. He restored the foundations of our past. He enabled us to be called a nation that repaired bridges, the cradle of the great earth. Beschreibe the Sibyl for Jobus, a nation that is worthy of creating the new civilization of total life. This is the heavenly wonder of our age. The Pelahelion of Yeshua and Nechama that has taken place in our day. Yes, out there still exists an awful wasteland. A tragedy of assimilation and ignorance and don't like a finds a way in life and they know what it is. These foul my back, Chalukim, from Claudius Oil, Tachman of Islam, Hashem Yerachim. And we must not, despite the pride that we have in our own accomplishments, the Ezras Hashem Yerachim, not forget for a moment our responsibility and our deep concern and our ahava for every Yid, for all Jews everywhere. V'ashrei chelko, from kol eila hayikohem, that giveth themselves to help, to nurture, to uplift Yiddish and Yishonis, drift in that wasteland. Agudas Yisroel has always considered it its sacred mission to uplift Klei Shemayim, to serve the needs of the Torah, the needs of the Shina HaKdoshe Kavayoko in this world. And segments of Klei Yisroel and its needs are considered our responsibility as an organization, as a movement, as a Chativa Achas, last is concerned of the Yushev Shemayim. And here again, we saw a wondrous sign of the Hashgacha that these past two generations will arose an individual that was selected from above and was entrusted with a shlichus, a mission, and was granted the siyata d'shmaya to successfully carry out what he considered to be the inner meaning of his life, to serve Klei HaTorah and Klei Yisroel Sova, and was humbly proud to be an Eved L'Avdei Hashem, a servant and an emissary of the Gdol Yisroel, with the purpose of preserving and expanding Klei Shemayim in our world, in our day. This permeated all his activities. This was the Shiva Sachayim of his existence. I mean, of course, a Moshe Shel as a friend of the Prophet. But the memory and the legacy that he left should also remain and be a challenge to the future, especially to the younger generation represented here tonight, who should, who must, raise their conscience to the needs of Torah, Yiddishkeit, and there are many. They must be met by a Ashkenazim joining the ranks of the Yeshiva Mitzvahe Tzibur Be'emuna in the Machna HaKodesh called Agudas Yisroel. Only thus can we continue and grow. Only thus can the Hiddik Agudas Yisroel, Rabbi Sai, I'm proud to use these words, that Elika Agudas Yisroel, only if it is given chizuk and support and participation by the Olam HaTorah, by the Balabatim that have grown up in the Machna HaTorah, only in this way can it become a greater than ever force to expand the frontiers of Torah Yiddishkeit. That is the message of tonight's dinner. I'd like also to pay tribute to the honorees here tonight, most of whom, those Baal Matikshet, those Baal Mahadein, whom I know, whom I knew. I won't go into detail, and I will not mention names, but these individuals stand as a conscience to all of us, because they've shown an understanding what Agudas Yisroel means, what it needs. Ashei chelkom yirotzen shetishre shchinde b'masi yadeinu b'masi yadeinu b'zoh helfen b'zoh zeiche sein to the siyata d'shmaya was the eibach that uns gishonken alle yorin.
Mas a chia do rastro foi. Ela me deu. Oh, yeah.